Hello, Tech World. This is Tech Thoughts, and welcome to this special Tech Thoughts video series focused on learning PowerShell. This is an operationally designed series that aims to get you spun up and using PowerShell quickly. This is episode 5 in the series, Working with PowerShell Variables. If you prefer written documentation, the corresponding article for this topic can be found on the techthoughts.info blog, which I've linked in the description below. So far in the Learn PowerShell series, we've been running commandlets directly each time we wanted new information. But as you start to write more advanced PowerShell, you're going to want to start saving that output from those commands into variables. Saving data into variables makes you a lot more efficient and can really expand your PowerShell capabilities. Let's start off with just typing in a quick git process. And when I click F8 in the VS Code editor, it will go ahead and run that in the context down here in the terminal. And we see the basic output of git process. So now let's just simply declare a variable in PowerShell, which is done with the dollar sign. So as soon as I do the dollar sign, that's telling PowerShell that I'm going to go ahead and declare a variable, and then we'll just go ahead and specify the variable name. So this will be the variable process. And I can go ahead and load that with git process. And I'll click F8. Notice that nothing has occurred down here in the terminal other than the process was loaded. So if I type in process in the terminal now, because that's loaded into memory, if I click enter, you'll notice that it contains the exact object data that git process did a moment ago. Let's explore why this makes us a lot more efficient and gives us more capability. So I'll go ahead and load up real quickly the following lines. So let's examine this real quick. This will git process where the object CPU is greater than 5,000. So all this is essentially doing is finding processes that are keeping the CPU a little bit busy. And notice this line, git process sort object working set 64 descending. This is sorting the processes by memory usage. So these are two ways that you can kind of massage the data that git process returns to give you some more insight into the information. So if I run the first command, there's nothing really keeping this particular machine very busy. So I can lower that number perhaps greater than 1000. Go ahead and click F8 and run that again. So only Firefox on this machine is keeping this processor at this moment in time a little bit occupied. And if I run this command here, this will sort all of my processes by memory and scroll up to the top. You'll see the process that's taking the most memory is Firefox. Now, this wasn't very efficient because we had to run git process twice in order to get those two different sets of data. Instead, we can use a variable and again load git process into the processes variable, which we declared using that dollar sign. I'll go ahead and click F8. You'll notice this is loaded into memory down in the console now. And now, instead of running git process again, I can take the variable which contains the git process information and pipe it and retrieve the information I would like to get. So I will pipe processes to where object, again, finding those processes that are keeping my CPU busy. Again, because we have that set to 5,000, nothing meets that criteria. I can lower that down to 1,000, run again, and we see Firefox is our busy process. Again, processes being piped and sorting by memory, and we get the exact same information. Because we only had to run git process once, we become a lot more efficient using variables in this example. One thing you need to know when working with PowerShell variables is that PowerShell is not a strongly typed language. Let me explain what that means. So let's declare a new variable, my new variable. So what type of data is this my new variable? Is it a string? Is it a Boolean? Is it an integer? Because PowerShell is not a strongly typed language, this particular variable has the capacity to become all of those things. So if you were to load in an integer, this would become an integer variable. If you were instead to load in a string, it would become a string. If you were instead to load in a Boolean, this would become a Boolean type variable. Let's explore why knowing this is so important when working with PowerShell data types. Consider the following example, declaring a variable of total equals 2 plus 2. I'll go ahead and load that using F8. And now, if I run F8 on this line, it will display what is inside total. And we can see total is, unsurprisingly, 4. 2 plus 2 being equal to 4. I'm going to go ahead and take total and pipe it to git member and determine what type of object I'm dealing with inside of total. So I'll click F8. And if I scroll up a little bit, you'll notice that total piped to git member is of type int32. So this is an integer variable type. Now, in the second part of this example, I'm going to load up that same total variable with equals 2 plus 2 inside of these single quotes, making this a string. So I'm going to go ahead and load that into memory. You'll see that right here. I'm going to go ahead and run this line, 25, click F8. And you'll notice that total now equals 2 plus 2. That's because this is a literal string and no longer an integer type variable. So total is literally containing 2 plus 2. I can prove this by piping total to get member. And when I click F8 on that, if I come up, notice that total to get member in this example is of system.string. Let's do another example so you can understand why understanding data types is so important inside of PowerShell. So go ahead and paste in this example and we'll run through it real quick. So our first variable, num1, is going to be equal to 2. I'm going to load that into memory. I'm also going to load num2 equals 2 into memory. Now, notice that we're using variables with other variables. So num1 plus num2 is essentially, in this example, 2 plus 2. So we'll go ahead and run this line right here, 32, load that into memory, and go ahead and put that out to the console by running line 33. And of course, we get 4 because 2 plus 2 is equal to 4. Let's do this again with string literals. I'll load num1 with 2 and num2 with 2 wrapped in quotes. I'm going to go ahead and run both of these lines at the same time. You can run multiple lines with F8 just by selecting and highlighting them. And you'll notice that once I load total in and output it, that it equals 22. So why does it equal 22? Well, it doesn't actually equal 22 because total, when piped to get member down here, is actually of type string. And what we did is we combined those two strings together. So this is of system string. And so we took the two, literal string, and combined that with the other one, giving us 22. So this is why it's so important to understand what type of variable you're working with, as it can drastically affect the results that you're trying to get after. Now, just because PowerShell is not strongly typed by default doesn't mean that you can't do that yourself. We can, for example, tell PowerShell explicitly that we want num1 and num2 to be of type integer. And we do that by front loading it with these brackets here and telling it the type of variable we would like it to be: integer, boolean, string, and so forth. So even though that I have this wrapped in quotes, which we showed a moment ago, makes that a string literal, we're telling PowerShell, don't care about those quotes. We're going to make num1 and num2 of type integer. So I'll go ahead and load those in to memory. And if I do a total equals num1 plus num2, like we see here, total down here is going to equal 4. Because despite the strings, we told it these are going to be integer variables, and it was able to perform that math operation with those as integer numbers. When working with PowerShell variables, it is possible that you may want to convert one type of variable to another type. Let's see how that is very easily accomplished in this line right here. So total, and we can demonstrate this down here again with getMember. GetMember is definitely your friend. GetMember on total right now shows that it's type int32, but you may want total to be instead a string. So I can declare another variable here, string return, and I can go ahead and take total and then use the method toString. So I'll go ahead and run this line. And notice that string return still contains 4, but string return, if I pipe that to get member, is now going to be of type string. You may be asking yourself, how did I know about the toString method? And what other things can I convert to? Well, I'm going to teach you how to very easily identify that, and that's with getMember, which we learned about in lesson 1. When you run getMember against things like a variable, it will tell you what type of object it is and if that object contains any methods associated with it. So when we did total and piped that to getMember, it told us that it was system int32, but it also tells us all of the various methods that that object has to work with, including toString. So you could also convert this to a 64 integer type. You could convert it to a Boolean, so on and so forth. All right, so let's spend a few minutes talking about quotes. You saw a moment ago that those can really impact the way that we operate with variables. So let's learn a little bit about how to work with quotes properly in PowerShell. I'm going to paste a few lines in here and I'm going to walk you through what they will entail. So here I have a variable literal and I'm loading in a string with single quotes. Single quotes in PowerShell make a literal string. So if I load this into memory and then output that variable to the console, I'm going to go ahead and click F8. You'll notice that literal outputs to the console the literal string that's typed in there. 2 plus 1 equals $1 plus 2, which is exactly what we have typed here. This is a literal string in single quotes. But it is possible to escape operations and perform math within a string, for example. But this requires the use of double quotes. So notice here in the escaped variable, I'm using double quotes here on both sides. And in here, there's a special syntax for telling PowerShell, I want this section, the dollar sign and whatever is in parentheses, to be a variable. So whatever is inside of here, I want that to be the thing that's returned. So because this is 2 plus 1, we would expect this to return 3. Because this is in double quotes, it will perform that math operation. And we'll go ahead and click F8. F8 again on the escape line, and notice that we get 2 plus 1 equals 3. So when you want your string to contain dynamic information, or if you want your string to contain variables, you need to use double quotes. If you literally want to type or display or work with a string exactly as you present it, then you need to use single quotes with a literal string. Here's a quick bonus example that we can demonstrate with write host, which will write out to the console. So we'll write host $escaped. So escaped at this point should equal, we can show that down here, 2 plus 1 equals 3. And if we write host, notice that it only writes escaped. Again, these are single quotes. There is no variable here. It will literally type out to the screen exactly what you type in the literal string. If we instead copy that, change the singles to double quotes, you'll notice in the editor that this will immediately turn blue, designating that there's an actual variable stored there. And if we write host escaped, we get the 2 plus 1 equals 3, which is loaded inside of this variable. So as you continue to work with PowerShell, just remember there's a big difference between single quote and double quote. So now let's take a moment to explore some of the reserved variable types inside PowerShell. So there are a couple of constant variable names that PowerShell kind of reserves for itself in its own use. You can see a list of those by typing in get variable. So I'll come down here into the console. And if you want to know how I blew that up just now, there's a little arrow over here where you can maximize the panel size and kind of hide your work area up here and instead work directly in the console. So I'm going to type in get variable. And this will list every single variable that's currently in this particular PowerShell session. There are a couple of ones that are just by default used by PowerShell. For example, the home variable. The reason you need to know about these is because you cannot use them. They are reserved for PowerShell. So you may be thinking to yourself, like, I would like to write home and declare home as a variable, and I'll set that equal to a string literal of C test. We'll go ahead and click F8, and notice we get an error that says, I cannot overwrite the variable home because it's read-only. So if you ever declare a variable that matches one of the constant reserved, you are going to get this type of error. Again, you can type in get variable to find a list of those ones that PowerShell uses by default. Along those same lines, there's also some environment variables. So when PowerShell runs inside of an environment, it creates a couple of environment variables specific to that environment it's running in. You can also find a list of these by typing in get child item and then env colon, which is for environment. So if you F8 on this, it will return a whole bunch of environment variables. And you'll notice these are specific to this particular session. Things like the username. This is the user I'm currently logged in as. The client name. The name of the computer. Environment variables are a little bit special inside of PowerShell because they contain env in front of the variable name. So normally you would think of something like computer name, but for an environment variable, this is actually designated with the env colon in front. And so if you click enter on this, we didn't populate this, PowerShell did this. And so this computer name is called tech-dev. If I want to find the user I'm working as, environment, I can type in user, click tab. I got user domain. I've got user domain roaming profile. There's a couple of environment variables in here. And then of course, username is TechThoughts. Environment variables are pretty handy. So make sure that you understand what you have at your disposal. You may find that PowerShell is already aware of some information that you don't need to go find. Okay, so let's close out by putting this all together with an example that now, based on what we've learned, we should be able to walk through pretty easily so that you can start seeing the power of working with variables inside of PowerShell. So the first line that we're going to be running here is declaring path and then setting that equal to read host, which is going to prompt the user with a string literal. And we know it's a string literal because it's wrapped in single quotes, which says, please enter the file path you wish to scan for large files. So we'll go ahead and run that now. And if I click F8, you'll notice that the first thing we get is please enter the file path you wish to scan for large files. I'll go ahead and type in C test. On your device, you'll need to obviously adjust for the appropriate path. For Linux users, obviously /for you. Go ahead and click enter. So at this point, if I pound out path down here in the console, it does contain C test. On our second line, we're declaring another variable, raw file data. And this is being set to the results of get child item, which is going to be scanning the path that we just loaded in recursively and finding all the files inside of that and loading that into raw file data. So I'll go ahead and click F8. And now if I pound that out, you'll notice that it does contain a couple of file objects inside of that. So continuing to utilize variables, we're taking another variable that we're going to declare, large files, and we're going to utilize the raw file data, but then only return the objects where the length is greater than 100 meg. So we're looking for those larger files. I'm going to go ahead and click F8, and notice that this takes large files down to just one file, a very large test TXT file. Continuing on, starting to see some of the use cases of these variables that you're working with, we can, of course, load up another variable, large files count. We'll take large files, we'll measure how many objects there are, one in this example, and then we'll select object, how many there are from the count. So this will load up just the count of how many large files are returned. So we'll go ahead and run F8. And if we pound out large files count, I put large files there, which still contains that one large file. I need large files count. It does contain one. And so we can write back to the user, you have this many stored in our variable, large files in path. Remember again that I did use double quotes here because I do have variables inside of this string that I want to remain dynamic and provide information back to the user. So if I run this line here, you have one large file in C test. Because of this, this is very easy to now troubleshoot. You can check which each variable contains on its journey through the final outcome, which allows you to look inside of your code and make sure that it's being loaded with the things that you expect. This also makes the code very repeatable and extensible. So I can, of course, load all this in again, click F8. I can type in C test, and it immediately returns you have one large file in C test. And of course, I can go ahead and run this again, specify a different path, C temp. And I don't have any large files in that particular directory. Remember that all of this information is available in written format on the techthoughts.info blog. If this video helped you out, go ahead and click that like button and subscribe for more Tech Thoughts videos.